Prime Minister refused to answer directly when asked whether his government would be open to defunding the RCMP, one of the key demands from some groups protesting the death of George Floyd at the hands of the Minneapolis police officer. They want the government to slash police budgets in favor of funding programs that support and empower minority groups, and that call to action is slowly gaining a lot of political will. This week, for example, the Los Angeles mayor, Eric Garcetti, announced that he'd be cutting $100 to $150 million from the LAPD's $1.8 billion budget. The idea is to broaden the definition of security by pouring that money into things like poverty reduction or social housing. Will Canada see similar follow-through? Is defunding the police really a solution to stop the race-motivated violence? Let's find out. Joining me now is the former OPP commissioner and now the CTV public safety analyst, Chris Lewis. And also joining us is the Black Lives Matter co-founder, Sandy Hudson. She's in LA. Good to see both of you again. Sandy, let me just start with you. This notion of systemic racism inside police forces, the data on things like carding and incarceration rates in Canada is overwhelming, yet many political leaders like the Premier of Quebec deny there's any systemic racism in the police forces. What's your response to that?
I think that's particularly embarrassing for Canada to be stuck in this weird question of whether or not anti-Black racism exists. I think the data tells us, and experiences that people have spoken about in the public for so long, that very clearly anti-Black racism exists in this society. And it also tells us that Black people's power in political spaces like where laws are being made are not at the level where it should be, because if it was, they would not be able to make those types of blatantly ridiculous statements. It really is quite an embarrassment and something that we need to move past so that we can focus on providing solutions to the problems in our society.
Chris Lewis, let me go to you. You're the former head of the commissioner of the OPP, the largest police force in Ontario. For many, the data is overwhelming. There's systemic racism in the police forces. Do you accept that?
I don't at all. I certainly accept the fact there is racism, without a doubt. And I mean, it is all through society, and it is also in police departments. The problem I have with the word systemic is that suggests to me that it's pervasive through the entire organization, including all the people, the leaders, and the policies. And I just don't see that in policing. I see embarrassing cases of racism, extra use of force, and the carding situation was very slanted towards people of color, and that's all wrong, and it just can't exist. But I just noticed that it's not pervasive through every police department in the province, or in Canada. I just don't see that at all.
Sandy.
If I can respond to that, Evan, I just think that is a faulty understanding of what the word systemic means. A systemic means that it is a part of the system. It is the way that the system is constructed, is how anti-Black racism is functioning. And so when you see something, a statistic like Black people in Toronto are 20 times more likely to die at the hands of the police, that is what we mean by systemic. I'm not talking about anybody's individual attitudes. I can't change those things, and I don't intend to focus there. I'm trying to change the way that we carry out our safety and security services in this province, in this city, and beyond, because quite frankly, our lives are worth examining how to change that problem that is so obviously embedded in the system.
Chris, some say that when people deny that there's systemic racism, that they are, as Sandy just said, they're missing the point. Do you appreciate what she's trying to say?
I totally appreciate what you're trying to say. I just, right away, we go to Toronto and we go to the carding situation, which was abysmal. There's no arguing it. I'm not here to defend the police. I just don't want the public to have the perception that policing is rife with racism across this country, because I don't see it. It's happening in pockets. It's happening more in some municipalities than others. Certainly within maybe some OPP detachments, there's more than others. Just to use that example. Or some divisions in Toronto. But this country isn't perpetuated by racism in policing. Some systems need to be fixed. We need to do better, need to continually make positive change. But I just don't think it's fair to categorize policing in this country as being systemically racist.
Sandy, one of the ideas that has emerged, and you've been one of the people that have talked about this, is defunding the police Can you describe why you believe that might be a solution?
Absolutely. And just to respond to that last comment, like, you know, I'm coming to you with data that shows exactly how Black people are being treated across this country and Indigenous people by the police. And what I'm hearing back in response is defensiveness and conjecture. And I don't need that. We need to move to solutions. And that's what I intend to focus on. And so when we're talking about defunding the police, that is a solution to one of these problems. In Canada, we know that many of the people who die at the hands of the police, we're experiencing a mental health crisis. And we also have in Toronto or the Iacobucci report that tells us that that was released in 2014 and tells us that the police are not well equipped to deal with mental health crises. And so why don't we create a new service, a new emergency service where people would have the option to call experts who are trained to deal with the health needs and social needs of people who are experiencing a mental health crisis. And that way, those people maybe don't show up with lethal force. And that way, we can ensure that people get the support that they need from people who are trained to deal with that very particular complex situation.
Chris, when you hear defund the police and you hear how it's defined, I mean, I get that people say, wait a sec, we need the police. But Sandy and others are talking about expanding the definition of security and doing, for example, so the police, there's another force that can handle things like mental illness. Do you buy that? Do you think that's how we should reallocate our money?
I do, for sure. I mean, it has to happen in a very methodical way. And Iacobucci's report in 2014 resulted in a lot of positive change. A lot of it was occurring before his report, much since. The whole community engagement model and bringing mental health professionals and different social services agencies and educators and others to the table to try and solve police issues before they become police issues is very important. That needs to continue. And that should result in positive change in terms of the need for the number of police. But in the meantime, you still need armed police, and you still need the ability to respond to incidents with firearms. And that's a scary thing. I realize that, but it's a reality policing. You need critical mass to deal with things.
What about body cams? You can't send a mental health professional to a murder scene. Sandy, there's a debate about body cams. People keep saying now, this violence has always been there. The only difference is it's being filmed. We've got to get body cams on everybody. Then the police unions will say, well, you want body cams? Okay, that's going to cost you. So you can't both defund the police and get body cams. What's your view on police wearing body cams?
Sure. And also just to respond to the last question or the last comment, in the UK, frontline police officers are not armed. And I think that that is something that we can consider here as well. With respect to body cameras, I'm not in favor of those things. When we take a look at the research, it shows either that body cameras have no impact on a police officer's likelihood to use lethal force, and in some studies shows that police officers are more likely to use lethal force when they're using body cameras. We have all sorts of accountability measures already in place that the police do not respond to. Even when we see that they're acting improperly, they don't change the way that they do policing. And so I don't understand what seeing more of us die is going to do if the police have already shown us that they are unwilling to change their practices. I don't want to see more of us dying. I want the police to stop killing us. And I think the best way forward to do in terms of doing that is to provide our safety and security measures services in another way.
Chris, last word on that. Body cams, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, to say that the police are not willing to make change, that's not true whatsoever. Police leaders and officers are trying to make change. I think body cameras are great. They don't always cover all the right angles, but there's certainly cases that they really tell the tale, rightly or wrongly, on behalf of the police. And at other times about complaints of what cops said or didn't say, as the case may be.
Guys, this is an important discussion and a critical debate that the world is having right now. I want to thank Chris Lewis, former OPP commissioner, and Sandy Hudson, the co-founder of Black Lives Matter Toronto. Great to have both of you on a really candid and important debate. Coming up on our program, though, U.S. President...